thank you, Patrick. And again, thanks to the Utah Medical Association's financial services. It's with pleasure that I get to announce our keynote speaker for the day. He is Dr. Richard Gunderman. And Dr. Gunderman is the Chancellor's Professor of Radiology, Pediatrics, Medical Education, Philosophy, Liberal Arts, Philanthropy, and Medical Humanities and Health Sciences at Indiana University. Dr. Gunderman is the 10-time recipient of the Indiana University Trustees Teaching Award. And in 2008, he was the outstanding educator for the Radiological Society of North America. In 2012, he was the distinguished educator of the American Rankin-Rae Society. I've enjoyed reading Dr. Gunderman's comments and articles over the years in The Atlantic and various medical journals. Dr. Gunderman has published 12 books, two that are available for us out in the lobby are We Make a Life by What We Give, and We Come to Life with Those We Serve. I'm very happy that Dr. Gunderman has been able to join us from Indiana, and I'd like to welcome him to the stage.
Good afternoon. It's a treat to be here. I've had occasion to visit a number of state and county medical societies, and I'm impressed that perhaps in absolute terms, but certainly as a proportion per capita, this is the largest medical association I've ever visited. Congratulations to you. This appears to be an extraordinary organization, and I hope someday to get to learn more about your history, because you are clearly doing something special here that the rest of the nation needs to learn about. I don't know if you know, but organized medicine is in the doldrums, and we need to develop collegiality and community within the profession of medicine. And it seems to me that you're past masters at that, and it would be a treat to try to understand what you've been doing and share those lessons with some other locations around the country. So I'm a pediatric radiologist. I practiced in the nation's 13th largest children's hospital. And I was born and bred to think that as physicians, we enjoy no more important resources than our knowledge and our skills. From, I don't know about you, but you know, I had board scores, step 1, 2, and 3 scores, MCAT scores, SAT or ACT scores, all the way back to APGAR scores. My mission, you know, was to get the top score on whatever test I was taking. And obviously, if we don't possess the scientific and clinical knowledge, the skills that are an important part of our work, we've got no business calling ourselves doctors or members of other health professions. But that's not the whole story. I've come to think that one of our most important resources is not cognitive or technical, but rather, let's say, narrative. And I mean this in the very best sense of the term, perhaps even mythological. I think one of our most precious resources in medicine are, in fact, the myths that have shaped us into the physicians we've become and continue to guide us in the future. And those are very precious resources that deserve our utmost care and attention. What story do you tell yourself when you get up in the morning or when you show up at the office or the hospital? What story is ringing in your mind as you lay your head down on the pillow at night to sleep. I think one way to make medicine better, to enable us to provide better care to our patients, families, communities, is to discover and share and plumb the depths of the very best stories that are available to us. What story do you tell your children or your grandchildren about what it means to be a physician? Do you, in fact, talk with your children and grandchildren and nieces and nephews and maybe the neighbors' kids about what it means to be a doctor? These stories are strange in multiple ways. Here's one. The more time you share the story with your heart in it, the more deeply you yourself will understand the nature of the story you are sharing. What stories do you habitually share? The greatest individual, the most influential human being who ever walked the face of the earth. By the way, does anybody know who that is? And I'm not relying on my own inadequate abilities to make this determination. The nice people of MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, have studied the human beings who've lived up to this point and determined who among them was the most influential. Who is that? Jesus Christ ranks number 3. Other ideas? By the way, this is MIT talking, not me. Jesus is number 3. Number 4 is Socrates. Number 2, Plato. And the most influential human being who ever lived, Aristotle. You tell me if that's right, but that's what MIT says. What did Aristotle say? In essence, you and I are becoming what we habitually do, what we habitually say, what we habitually think and feel, what we habitually long for. What is your heart set on? And what are you in fact becoming by virtue of that longing? That's a serious question for the profession of medicine. We have a lot of scientific, technical, political, economic issues before us. We need the best minds in our field working hard on those problems. But we also need our colleagues, and we ourselves need to be thinking about the stories that we hold in our hearts, which constitute fundamentally the stars by which we steer. You know, not what's happening in this quarter or what the OR schedule or the lecture schedule looks like this week, but in terms of a bigger picture, a longer sense of time, where are we headed? Why are we trying to get there? And what are you and I doing to help guide and propel us along that journey? So that's the spirit in which I want to speak with you today, that this narrative resource that doesn't always get the attention it deserves is vitally important. And when we tell ourselves the best stories we have available, we begin to realize that our lives are made up, our lives are defined, not so much by what we've managed to get. Maybe you've accumulated a great deal of wealth. Maybe you enjoy a position of authority, power in one or more organizations. Maybe you're particularly well known. Maybe you've published a lot of papers, gotten a lot of grant dollars, won a variety of awards. But the proposition would be that we make a life not so much by what we get as by what we give. That is, that our mission here is to contribute as much as we possibly can. And I think that's a vital message we need to be reminded of. Now, what do you have to give? Well, I can write checks. Certainly, philanthropy in the conventional sense, sharing our wealth, is an important way of giving. But of course, we have many other opportunities to give, many other resources we can draw on, such as, time is a big one. How many minutes does Jeff Bezos, the richest person in America and perhaps the world, how many minutes does he have at his disposal today? That requires a little math. How about how many hours does Jeff Bezos have at his disposal on this date? Well, the answer, of course, is 24. How many hours do you and I have? Well, the answer is the exact same 24. Jeff Bezos with his $125 billion, I think that's post-divorce settlement, but I'm not sure, $125 billion can't buy an extra hour or an extra minute or even an extra second. Could it be that the most important resources available to us as human beings are distributed far more equally, perhaps equitably, than we commonly suppose? And by the way, there's some resources that you and I can actually share, and that far from being diminished in the sharing, actually grow. There are some things you can share that after you've shared them, you actually possess more than before you decided to share them, such as? What resource do you have that grows in the sharing? Yeah, I would say one, but you might say, this doesn't count. I don't count this as a resource because I can't value it in economic terms. I can't ascribe a dollar value to it. But here's one, may sound a little hokey, maybe a little too soft and feely, but one such resource would be knowledge. When you share the best of what you know with someone else, you typically leave that encounter with more than you started with. And here's another one, love. I would submit to you that our capacity to love isn't diminished or exhausted, but is in fact enhanced when we love, and particularly when we love at our best. If that were true, the magic possible in human life might be best realized not by taking and getting, accumulating and hoarding, but in fact by sharing and contributing. What possibilities lie open to you today, this week, this month, this year, to share the best of what you have? Perhaps treasure, but also time and talent. One thing you can share at this meeting today is your attention, your capacity to attend to what someone else is feeling or thinking or speaking about. That's a marvelous capacity. What greater resource do we have to share with people? So I'm going to try to make the case that we may make a living by what we get, but we make a life by what we give. That the best life possible for us is not a life of accumulation, but a life of sharing. And I want to draw on a particular person whose story I want to remind you of and share with you today. You might ask yourself, who in my life have I encountered whose story I would want to share in this situation? Trying to make the case that it's what we give that ultimately defines us and adds meaning to the lives we're living. So I want to talk about somebody from my home state of Indiana and introduce at least somebody well known in what's perhaps your home state of Utah. I'll introduce him first as a bit of a mystery person. This is a photograph taken in the late 1920s of a team that won the Indiana High School Basketball Championship. Perhaps some of you have seen, say, the film Hoosiers. Maybe you remember Gene Hackman, Barbara Hershey. It's about a little school called Hickory in the film. The real name of the school was Milan. It's still known in my state 60 years later as the Milan Miracle, but a little school that managed to triumph over much bigger schools with much greater talent pools and win the Indiana High School Basketball Championship. This happened about 25 years before that. Somewhere in this picture is our mystery person who played in three consecutive Indiana State High School Basketball Championship games. He himself was named All-State three times, a rare honor in our state. And in 1927, his team won the state championship. He then went on to play at Purdue University, the Boilermakers, where he was named a three-time consensus All-American. I stand before you not as a tall human being. With my shoes on, I'm probably about 5 feet 10 inches tall. Our mystery person and I have one thing in common. He too stood 5 feet 10 inches tall. Even then, basketball was a big person's game, but he managed to be three times All-State, three-time consensus All-American at the height of 5 feet 10 inches, a pretty remarkable achievement. After his career at Purdue, he went on to play professional basketball and set a record, still far unbroken, of hitting 138 consecutive free throws. By the way, does anybody know what college the NCAA all-time record holder for most consecutive free throws plays at? By the way, this individual still playing college basketball. The all-time NCAA record, Division I, II, or III, the person who's hit the most consecutive free throws without a miss. Well, the answer, as you might guess, in my self-serving way, happens to be my alma mater, a little liberal arts school in western Indiana called Wabash College, where a player just this past season hit 95 consecutive free throws. By the way, he missed on number 96 and number 97. I guess he got a little flustered. Wooden's record, though, in pro ball is 138. Want to guess how he shot the ball? Granny style, with backspin on the ball. Who would dare do that now? Anybody know who did that in the recent history of professional basketball? Rick Barry, who I believe is the NBA's highest free throw percentage holder. By the way, our mystery man isn't in the center of the picture. As we look at it, he's just to our right of center. So he goes on to coach first high school, then college at Indiana State College in Terre Haute, Indiana. Who's the most famous basketball player to come out of Indiana State? Yeah, Larry Bird, the Hick from French Lick. Then he got a job coaching the UCLA Bruins. And as head coach of the UCLA Bruins men's basketball team, his teams won 10 championships, including 7 in a row, and perhaps the most unbeatable record of all, they won 88 consecutive games. Interestingly, they won game number 1 of that streak and lost game 89 in the same place versus the same team. What was that? Anybody remember the longest winning streak in NCAA men's basketball history started and ended at the same school? The answer is Notre Dame in South Bend, Indiana. This man becomes Coach of the Year 6 times. He's the first individual ever elected to the Hall of Fame as both a player and a coach. As a player in 1961, and as a player in 1973. And in some polls, Sports Illustrated, the Sporting News, I could go on, he has been selected as the greatest coach in the history of American sports. Not the greatest men's basketball coach or the greatest basketball coach, but the greatest coach in the history of sport. You might agree with that, you might disagree with that, but I don't think anybody could argue John Wooden is at least one of the greatest coaches in the history of American sport. Who was this guy? What made him tick? He came from a little town in our state that nobody in my state would know called Hall, Indiana, but became the greatest coach in the history of American sports. What was John Wooden up to? What did he think his career and his life were about? And what could you and I, as medical professions, professionals learn from perhaps the greatest coach there's ever been? I think the answer is a lot. This is John Wooden posing at the behest of the UCLA Alumni Office with some of the trophies his teams won over the years. How do you think he feels about posing for this photograph? The most successful coach in history posing with his team's trophies, a lifetime, a career of unparalleled success in athletics. How does he feel about posing for this photograph? What do you think? He looks uneasy. Why do you think John Wooden looks uneasy? If anybody has reason to beam with pride when it comes to athletics, at least the coaching of sports, it's John Wooden. But I think most of us would agree he doesn't seem to be beaming with pride. Why not? Yeah, because John Wooden knows that this photograph is a lie. It's a deception. It's a misrepresentation. Why? Because John Wooden didn't win any of those trophies, right? In every case, it was a team effort, and that's what John Wooden stood for as a coach and as a person. Suppose we arranged a photo session for you, you personally, with all your awards, surrounded by all your professional accolades, all the contributions you've made as a community servant, perhaps a servant of a faith tradition. There you are with all those awards. What would be going through your heart? How would you feel about posing for that portrait? Well, Wooden clearly felt uncomfortable. He's in kind of an Adams pose, right? A very defensive posture, because this is, in a way, an abrogation of a philosophy that shaped his entire career and his entire life. Namely, that our excellence resides not in us, but in our capacity to contribute to the excellence of others. Wooden said, a great player is much less valuable than a player who makes the team great. What is your impact on the team? When you walk in the room, is the performance level of others elevated? Enhanced? Perhaps when some of us walk in the room, there's no effect. Perhaps for some of us, the effect is actually negative. What would it be like to come to work next Monday morning with this thought? Suppose you're a person who's susceptible, so to speak, to prayer. Lord God, help me do all I can to help the people I work with and the people I work for be and do their best. This isn't primarily about me. I'm not the focus here. My mission is to serve something beyond myself. Wooden was the kind of person, John Wooden, who thought we can't be at our best unless we're serving something beyond ourselves. What would that something be for you? How present, how omnipresent is that something else in the work you and I do every day? From Wooden's point of view, that's a very important question we need to ask ourselves on a daily, perhaps even hourly basis. So I want to talk about something some of you may have encountered before. John Wooden loved to tell the story of how when he graduated from the eighth grade in Centerton, Indiana, another town that virtually nobody, even in Indiana, has ever heard of, when he graduated from the eighth grade, his father gave him an index card. On one side was a poem, and on the other was what John Wooden described as a seven-point creed. What's a creed? Comes from Latin, like credo. What do you believe? To ask what is your creed is to ask what do you believe. How many of us could say in a compact space of time what we believe in? Well, if you press John Wooden, he had in his back pocket or his breast pocket copies of that very index card. And he could tell you seven things he believed. This is John Wooden's father, Joshua, on our left, and his mother on our right. His father didn't have any schooling beyond the eighth grade. He was a man who worked with his hands. He didn't have an MD or a PhD, an MBA or an MPH. He didn't even have a BS or a BA or an AB. All he had was a lifetime of experience. And he had found in these 7 points a credo that he could live for, and he felt his son, Johnny, should do the same. He handed that card to his son and said, "Johnny, if you live by these 7 points, you'll do okay." And John Wooden kept those with him. And I want to go through those 7 points. You can see them there. Be true to yourself. What exactly does that mean? Sounds like a speech from Hamlet for those who tune to thine own self be true, right? Help others. Give thanks for your blessings. What blessings? In what way might we say we have been blessed? How rich and complete is our account of our blessings? Drink deeply from good books. What was the last good book you read? I can't tell you how many people, when I ask them that question, look down or away. What was the last good book you read? I ask this regularly of applicants to medical school, residency programs, fellowship programs, people seeking positions on the faculty of a medical school or university. What was the last good book you read? The most common response I get, kind of a deer in the headlight look, followed by the question, well, what do you mean, book? You mean like Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine? You mean like Cotran and Kumar's Robin's Pathologic Basis of Disease, Goodman and Gilman? Is that what you're talking about here? Maybe not. You know, that's the science. That's the technology. But a human being is not adequately nourished merely by science and technology. To be good doctors, we must first be good human beings. And to be good human beings, we need good ideas, good stories to live with. What are you doing to replenish your supply of good ideas and good stories with which you live and practice medicine? Number five, build a shelter against a rainy day. What does that mean? Does that mean, my life insurance, my health insurance, my disability insurance, my home and auto insurance, they're all paid up? Maybe, but maybe there's other kind of precipitation in human life beyond the financial kind. What would it mean to build a kind of resilience in a deeper and more comprehensive sense? Make friendship a fine art. How many of the people you graduated high school with are you still in regular contact with? Or college or medical school? That's not meant to embarrass anybody, but how important a part of our life has friendship been over the course of our lives? And what do we do to maintain and build those ties as our lives go on? And then finally, make each day your masterpiece. Anybody remember today's date, like May 16th? 16th? Suppose I told you that May 16th, 2019 is meant to be one of your masterpieces. This very day is meant to be a masterpiece for you. Suppose I had a video recording of everything you've done today since your eyes flickered open early this morning. Now we're reviewing the footage. How plausible is it that May 16, 2019 is going to be a masterpiece for you? Is there anything you could be doing between now and the time your head hits the pillow tonight to make today a masterpiece, or at least increase the probability that it might become one? So we'll go through each of these points of the seven-point creed. And, this isn't intended to be a list of rules. It's not a policy and procedure manual. It's not a set of laws, that somebody could simply memorize and follow. These are really, I think, more in the nature of provocations to think and to think deeply, not only with our heads but with our hearts, about the kind of lives we aspire to lead and how those aspirations might be reflected in our practice of medicine. Who knows what's deep in your heart? Who knows where your fondest longings and hopes really lie? To what extent is that clear to the people you work with every day? They couldn't fail to notice it. Or in fact, I've been keeping that light hidden under a bushel basket for virtually my entire career. And I'd be surprised if any of my colleagues has even an inkling of what really matters most to me. When that happens, we sell not only our colleagues, but ourselves disastrously short. So let's go through these seven points and see what we make of them. The first, that's John Wooden. Anybody know how old John Wooden was when he died? I'll just tell you that he was diagnosed with hypertension in his late 30s. And, the therapies available for treating hypertension back then weren't nearly as good as they are today. How old was John Wooden when he died? He was 99 years old. From a health point of view, he lived unexpectedly long. But, of course, as physicians, we know that things like blood pressure, pulse, respiration, temperature don't tell us the whole story about human vitality. We know that, don't we? We know that there are other things that sustain us in life, that draw us to life, maintain our zest for living. And one of those is waking up in the morning with a sense of purpose. I have a purpose today. I'm called to do something, to be something. My presence here, in a sense, matters. It counts for something beyond just what it means to me. If we can wake up with that sense in the morning, we, like John Wooden, might not only live a long time, but more importantly, might live every day along the way. You know, it's not enough just to be alive, to have a slim waistline, or a good BMI, or a desirable lipid profile. It's also important to actually live, you know, to use that health for some purpose beyond ourselves. John Wooden had that. Did he ever? When he woke up in the morning, he felt that he was answering a kind of call, that he had been summoned to that day for a reason. So Wooden at age, he's not quite 99 here, he's 97. But Wooden said your success comes not from victories. Wooden compiled an incredible record of wins and losses. He never had a losing season. His first year at Indiana State, his first year at UCLA, he transformed teams into championship contenders. There was something about Wooden, a kind of magic. He was a kind of athletic and maybe human catalyst, right? Who could help something happen that wouldn't otherwise happen if he weren't on the scene. Any human catalysts in this room? Any people with the capability to lead catalytic lives? Well, John Wooden could. And he said success comes not from victories, but from knowing everything, that you did everything you could to be the best you could be. Question isn't did you win or lose? Question is, did you perform as close as possible to your full potential? Who's the second best coach in the history of American sports? Number one, John Wooden. Same poll, Sports Illustrated, The Sporting News, ESPN. The number two coach in American sports history. Vince Lombardi, coach of the Green Bay Packers from, you know, let's say the decade of the 1960s. They asked Lombardi, who was the best player you ever coached? Gotta be Bart Starr, right? Gotta be Ray Nitschke. Gotta be Paul Hornung or Jim Taylor, you know, one of the superstars. Not what Lombardi said. Who did Vince Lombardi name as the greatest player he ever coached? Forrest Gregg. You may not even remember Forrest Gregg, but he was, get this, long before that Michael Lewis book, The Blind Side, Vince Lombardi named as the greatest player he ever coached an offensive tackle. An anonymous position. Why did he name Forrest Gregg? Who, by the way, went on to coach the Packers half dozen years after Lombardi died. Why did he say Forrest Gregg? Because he felt like when Forrest Gregg was on the field, or even on the sidelines, or even at practice, there was no person, no player he had ever coached who did more to bring out the best in his team. This was a guy who, when he was there, everybody else tended to perform better. What is that? I don't think we can bottle that, but we might be able to learn something about that And if we could, we might be able to put it into practice in our own lives. So this is John Wooden when he played for the Purdue Boilermakers. He was known as the India Rubber Man because Wooden would leap across the floor, dive for a free ball, a loose ball, and contort himself into any position he had to get possession of that ball. He was incredibly quick, and he was quick not so much because he had a faster reaction time than the rest of us, but because, to paraphrase Wayne Gretzky, he didn't go where the ball was. He went to where the ball was going to be. And that made him very quick. Wooden said, "Don't measure yourself by what you've accomplished, but by what you should have accomplished with your ability." What's the bottom line on the first point? Basically, you have to follow the Socratic injunction. Remember Socrates, the fourth most influential human being who ever lived. What did Socrates say? If you went to consult I'm thinking about getting married, thinking about having a child. I think about applying for a new job. I'm thinking about taking the troops into battle tomorrow. Before you do that, in ancient Greek culture, you'd go consult the oracle at Delphi. And as you approached the oracle, you walked under an archway. And that archway had on it two words. What were they? Know yourself. Know yourself. In order to know what we're capable of accomplishing, we need to really know ourselves. What are you capable of? What could you contribute today under the very best circumstances? What can you and I do to help create the circumstances under which you could make your greatest possible contribution? That's a question worth pondering, not for a lifetime, but for each day that makes up a lifetime. And that was the kind of person John Wooden was. Number two, help others. We're members of the helping profession, right? You got medicine, nursing, I don't know, dentistry, PT and OT, medical social workers, chaplains. I mean, we are part of the helping profession. Surely we've got that base covered. See right here, it says MD. Of course I'm a helper. Case closed. Not from Wooden's point of view. Wooden would say you could be, a high-powered MD with an impeccable academic pedigree and an extraordinary track record of professional success and still somehow not be as oriented as you could be and should be to helping others. Wouldn't like to talk about not the willingness to sacrifice personal interest for the welfare of all. By the way, that's John Wooden, 5'10" tall. Notice he's dwarfed by his players. The roster of the UCLA men's basketball team. You can see in the foreground there, number 32, Bill Walton, 6'11" tall, more than a foot taller than his coach. Lou Alcindor, whom we know as Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, the greatest scorer in the history of basketball, stood 7'2" tall. But players like Walton and Alcindor looked up to John Wooden, not because of his physical stature, but because of who he was as a human being. And what did it mean to look at things from Wooden's point of view? I'm not only willing, I am positively eager to sacrifice my own interest or gain for the sake of the team, for the sake of all. That's what it means to lead a life of significance. Not to look out for number one, not to accumulate as much as we possibly can, but to hold nothing back. to give our all, the very best we have in service of others and purposes that lie beyond us. So it's the eagerness to sacrifice personal interest of gain for the welfare of all. How do you fare on the eagerness scale? Is this an aspiration with which you wake up in the morning? If the answer is yes, from Wooden's point of view, you're probably on the path to a good life. Anybody recognize that guy? Who is that? Who is he? Basketball John. His name? John Stockton. Who's he? The best. Guess who agreed with you? John Wooden. Wooden never coached John Stockton, but they asked Wooden, who's the greatest professional basketball player? Wooden said John Stockton of the Utah Jazz. Why did he pick Stockton? I mean, he had coached two of the greatest players in history, right? Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Bill Walton, and a host of others. The very best basketball talent in the United States in the 60s and 70s. But he picked John Stockton. Why? Stockton to Malone. That's great. Yeah, who's number two on the all-time scoring list? Karl Malone. That's exactly right. John Stockton, in fact, holds a record. More than one, but a big one. What's that? The all-time assist leader. Who's number two? NBA all-time assist leaders. Number one, John Stockton. Number two, Jason Kidd. The gap separating Stockton and Kidd? A chasm. These are round numbers. Stockton had 17,000 career assists. Kidd, 13,000. That's a huge, perhaps unbridgeable gap. Why did Wooden think so highly of Stockton? Because from Wooden's point of view, when Stockton was on the court, there was an eagerness to contribute to the excellence of everyone else on the team and the team as a whole. He did more to elevate the level of play of his teammates than anybody else in basketball. Not the scoring leader, not the rebound leader, not the person with the biggest shoe contract or the highest annual salary and bonuses, but the all-time assist leader. What if I said you're meant to be an assist leader? What would that look like in your professional life? What does that even mean, an assist? I'm a surgeon. I'm a pediatrician. I'm an internist. I'm a physiatrist. What the heck does an assist look like in medicine? Well, who's the most influential person in human history? Anybody remember? Aristotle. What did Aristotle say? If you don't see the goal you're striving for, you're unlikely to hit it. You are like a blindfolded archer who might once in a great while hit the target, but deserves no credit for doing so. To hit our target, to reach our goal, to promote our aspirations, we need to see what we're striving for. And from Wooden's point of view, John Stockton was somebody who saw what he was striving for on the basketball court. Number three, give thanks for blessings. This is Wooden with his wife Nell. Or Nellie, Wooden described her that they met in high school. he described her as the only girl he ever went with. John Wooden and his wife Nell, learning that he's going to be the new men's head basketball coach at UCLA while they're still in Terre Haute, Indiana. That's Wooden with his great-granddaughter. Wooden said, "You can't have a perfect day without doing something for someone who will never be able to repay you. Not somebody who won't repay you, or somebody who won't make the effort to repay you, but somebody who will never be able to repay you. This is not some kind of investment from which I personally hope to reap a return. This is giving, sharing, contributing with no expectation of return." What would that look like for us? May 16, 2019. I'm going to do something for someone today who will never be able to repay me. Perhaps you've already done it, but perhaps many of us in the room haven't. What might we do today to live up to this aspiration of John Wooden? We live, I think, to some degree in a culture of scarcity, a culture of deficiency, where we like to focus on what's wrong, what's broken, what's lamentable, what contributes to a sense of pessimism, maybe even cynicism about medicine, about our community, about the nation in which we live, about the prospects for humanity. Lots of evidence, we're being bombarded with it every day, that things are bad and may be about to get worse. Wooden's counsel: focus first on the many blessings we enjoy, because your capacity to contribute will hinge directly on the degree to which you live with a sense of abundance. If your deep psychic reality is one of scarcity or deficiency, it's going to be very hard for you to contribute and to share to the full extent possible. On the other hand, if you approach each day with a sense of abundance, the things that really matter, I have in equal measure today as at any point in my life. I have in equal measure with every human being on the face of the earth, things like 24 hours and 60 minutes, each of those hours, and 60 seconds, each of those minutes. My capacity to give my whole attention, to be fully present with another human being. If we get up in the morning with that sense, above all perhaps our capacity to love, whatever it is a human being needs to love, I possess that in abundance. But that abundance will only come to life if I remind myself of it regularly. That was Wooden's approach to coaching basketball, but also to leading a human life. Number four, drink deeply from good books. A Sports Illustrated reporter named Rick Riley went to Wooden's home. It, oddly enough, was a 700-square-foot condominium in Encino, California. Isn't that odd that the greatest coach who ever lived passed the last decades of his life living in a 700-square-foot condominium in Encino, California? But that's the truth. There's Wooden with his wife, Nell, and their two children, a son and a daughter. The Sports Illustrated reporter expect to, you know, enter a kind of trophy room, right? You know, there'll be trophies and plaques and bronze-covered covers from Sports Illustrated, right? I mean, how could it possibly be otherwise? I'm going to the home of the greatest coach who ever lived. It's going to be all about sports. Nothing could have been further from the truth. In fact, you would have had to look hard to find any evidence that sports or athletics had been an important part of Wooden's life. What you found was not trophy cases, but shelves lined with books. The books that were important to Wooden, which he returned to again and again. You'd rarely see John Wooden without a book, you know, in his jacket pocket or in his briefcase. What book would you rarely be found without? If pressed to list a few of the books that have been most influential in your life, what would you cite? When was the last time you returned to that book? How alive is that book in your life today? You know, it might be a sacred text. Or texts might be a work of philosophy, theology, literature. Who knows? Maybe it's sculpture or paintings. But what are those texts for you? The books that have done more than any others to shape you into the person you are, to shape your aspirations for what kind of person you want to be, what kind of contribution you aspire to make in your life. Wooden knew the answers to those questions. What the reporter found were not trophies and plaques, but books and learning. And what the reporter chose to call morals. What interested Wooden was not victories and losses, but how to become a good person. What advice could you provide to a successor in medicine, or even to one of your own children or grandchildren, about how to become a good person and lead a worthy human life? John Wooden had answers to those questions. He saw his target. He saw clearly the destination he was striving toward, and that was apparent every day. His former players, over and over again, dozens, hundreds of players, attest to the fact that you knew what John Wooden stood for. And in some sense, that was to bring out the best in you as an individual, but more importantly, as the contributor to the excellence of a team. Number five, built a shelter for a rainy day. Anybody recognize that image? It's Ford Taurus. Happens to be a 1989 Ford Taurus. It's the show, the super high output 1989 Ford Taurus, not the model John Wooden owned. But John Wooden said for decades after that the best automobile he ever owned was his 1989 Ford Taurus. Non sequitur. What? The greatest coach in the history of sport thought the greatest car he owned was an 89 Taurus? That can't be right. When John Wooden retired as UCLA Bruins men's basketball coach, his salary in 1975 was $35,000. Non sequitur. That can't be right. To be sure, the consumer price index has moved since then. You know, maybe $35,000 in 1975 would be $100,000 today. Okay. Non sequitur. The greatest coach in the history of sport had as a highest annual salary $100,000? You're kidding. I mean, what does the coach at Utah or Alabama or Kentucky, what do they earn? John Wooden, by the way, never asked for a raise. You get that? He never asked for a raise. Possibility number one, John Wooden was crazy. He's a madman. A record like that, he never asked, never hired an attorney, an agent to negotiate for him. The man was clearly crazy. Possibility number two, John Wooden was stupid. He just didn't know what he had. He was a fool, you know, who could have made so much more if only he'd known. Possibility number three, that's for you to say. Is there a possibility number three? And if so, what might it have been? Here's what really mattered to John Wooden. Not his salary or his house or his car. What really mattered to John Wooden was his creed, his credo, what he believed in. And John Wooden hoped and perhaps even prayed that if he were ever prosecuted for his beliefs, there would be enough evidence to convict him. Suppose I called to the witness stand your five closest professional associates and subjected them to a rigorous examination to determine what they believe you believe. Could I collect enough evidence to convict you? Or would you go off scot-free? Would it turn out that, as far as anybody else knows, it's important for you to be punctual? It's important for you to be professionally attired. You care about getting your discharge summaries completed before the deadline. But as to deep beliefs, I don't think so. I see no evidence of that. You know, from Wooden's point of view, no matter how much wealth and fame and power, professional stature you've accumulated, if people don't know what really matters to you, not just because you've told them, but because you live it every day. If that's not the case, then an opportunity has been missed, and you've been performing short of your full potential. Number six, make friendship a fine art. Who's that tall guy? Yeah, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. When he played for John Wooden, known as Lou Alcindor, perhaps the greatest high school prospect in the history of American basketball, out of New York City. Wooden's a very old man at this point, not getting around terribly well. But when that Sports Illustrated reporter, Rick Riley, interviewed him, this is kind of a strange thing to do with a 98-year-old person, but Riley said, "Coach, I'd like to go through the rosters of your 10 championship teams to see what you can tell me about each of those players." So they went through the 180 players who'd ever been on the roster of a Wooden championship team. And it turned out Wooden could tell the reporter where they lived, what line of work they were in, whether they were married, how many kids they had, in 172 of 180 cases. You see, for John Wooden, coaching was not for college years alone. Coaching was for a lifetime. He saw the contributions he was trying to make to his players as extending even beyond a lifetime. If you don't live on a trajectory that extends beyond the point of your own death, then you're not really living, Wooden might have said. His relationships with his players turned out to be one of the things that mattered most to him in life. What relationships will turn out to have mattered most to you? And what are you and I doing today to testify to the importance of those relationships. Who haven't you spoken to lately? Who haven't you hugged lately? And what steps could you take today or this week or this month to rectify that missed opportunity? That's Wooden's heart is in it. His player, Bill Walton, I think is a little bit abashed. He doesn't know what to make of it. When he was on the team, the coach didn't hug him very often. But here's old John Wooden, not too long before he dies, hugging Bill Walton, one of the best few players he ever coached. And these are the words of Bill Walton. "The thing that gets me about Coach, there will be others who will win 10 championships. Heck, Phil Jackson has already won 10 NBA championships. But the thing that separates Coach from so many others is his focus on relationships. He truly loved his players. He was a man of genuine and enduring love." The L word. We're not supposed to bring that up, you know, at professional meetings, but there it is. What if I told you that someday they will say about you, I mean you personally, "She truly loved her patients. She truly loved her colleagues. She truly loved her neighbors. She truly loved her family. She was a person of genuine and enduring love." Likely? Unlikely? What would you rather have them say about you? "Always got those discharge summaries signed on time. Always in the 95th percentile for RVUs per FTE." Right? "Unparalleled record of patient throughput." What would you want him to say about you? How does the life you're leading stack up against what you would hope people would say about you? Wooden knew the answer to that question, and that's his secret. He saw clearly what he aspired to, and he let that permeate everything he did every day. How much do your aspirations permeate everything you do every day? Number 7, by the way, this is the last one, mercifully. "Make each day your masterpiece." This is Bill Walton again. By the way, Walton and Wooden had some run-ins. Walton was a self-described hippie. You know, Wooden's this conservative guy from the Midwest, pretty straight-laced, politically liberal in some respects, but basically a very conservative person. Walton described himself as a hippie, you know, kind of anti-authority. You may know this story. Walton showed up one season for practice, sporting long hair and a beard. Coach Wooden said, "Bill, you know the rules. No long hair, no facial hair." And Walton said, "Well, Coach, I know you believe in freedom of expression and, you know, the rights of individuals, civil liberties, and so forth." Wooden said, "Bill, you know the rules. And if you're not willing to follow them, all I can say is it's been great having you as a player on the UCLA Bruins men's basketball team." Walton had about 30 minutes before the team photo was going to be taken. He hopped on his bike and rode to a nearby barber shop and had all that hair cut off and just made it in time for the group photo for that season's squad. So the relationship between Wooden and Walton was not always an easy one. But here's Bill Walton thinking about John Wooden. Coach Wood never talked about winning and losing. Did you hear that? The greatest coach there ever was, not seldom or rarely, never talked about winning and losing. What do you talk about? RVUs, patient throughput, compliance with policies and procedures. Wooden didn't talk about that kind of stuff. Coach Wooden never talked about winning and losing, but rather about the effort to win. Did you make the effort? Did you do the best you could? He rarely talked about basketball. What? That would be like a doctor who rarely talks about medicine because there's something more important that needs to be interjected into the conversation. He didn't talk about basketball, he talked about life. He never talked about strategy, statistics, or plays. He talked about people and character. Coach Wooden never tired of telling us that once you become a good person, then you have a chance of becoming a good basketball player. I suspect the same holds true for the profession of medicine. If and when we become good human beings, we stand a chance of becoming good doctors. You know, who's the second greatest coach of all time? Vince Lombardi. Coach Lombardi. Why were the Green Bay Packers the best team in football history? You might contest that judgment, but that was the question as it was put to Lombardi. Why were the Green Bay big? Vince Lombardi, although he was only 5'8", 180 pounds, had been one of the seven men of granite at Fordham University. Coached football at the U.S. Military Academy. He was a tough guy. Coach Lombardi, why were the Green Bay Packers the best team in football history? And why were you such a great coach? I'll take those questions in reverse order. Why are you a great coach? Lombardi said, you know, other coaches know more than I do about X's and O's. Hugs and kisses? What's Lombardi talking about? X's and O's. How you diagram plays, right? Other coaches know more than I do about the strategy and tactics of coaching football. But there's one thing I know better than any of them. What was it? The hearts of my football players. Coach Lombardi, why were the Green Bay Packers the greatest team in football history? Brace yourself. This is Vince Lombardi's answer. Why were the Green Bay Packers the greatest team in football history? Here it comes. Because they loved each other. Hypothesis number one, Vince Lombardi was crazy. Hypothesis number two, Vince Lombardi was stupid. He just didn't understand. Possibility number three, once again, I'll leave that to you. Is there a third possibility? And if so, what might it be? But from Wooden's point of view, it was all about character. It was about human virtues, human excellences. How courageous are you? How compassionate are you? How generous are you? These are the kind of attributes, human excellences, that really turn out in the long run to make the big differences. So those are the 7 points of John Wooden's 7-point creed. The greatest coach in the history of American sport who never talked about the sport he coached, who never talked about winning and losing, who never talked about strategy and tactics. You know what John Wooden said about coaching during the game. You know, these days, you know, timeout, we're down by 1 point with 7 seconds on the clock. The team huddles around the coach. The coach is there, you know, with a dry erase board or something, diagramming a play. John Wooden's approach: all my work was done in practice. Once the game starts, I hope to be as surprised as the other team by what my players do. What? The greatest coach in history didn't coach during the game? Yeah. Now, why do you suppose that was? What does that exemplify? What message does that convey about John Wooden's philosophy of coaching? He trusted his players. Only they could see and respond to what was happening second to second out there on the court. Right? Even the best battle plans are obsolete the second the first shot is fired. To quote a great military theorist, he had imbued his players with a dedication to the excellence of the team. They functioned as well as they possibly could as a unit. And once the game started, Wooden's mission was to get out of the way. Who could do that? Somebody who trusted his players. Who do you trust? And who knows how much you trust them? That might be a key to coaching, a key to being a good doctor, and a key to living a good human life. Namely, that people know you believe in them. In fact, I would say that's actually one of the greatest gifts you can give anybody. It's not measured in monetary terms. You won't get any deduction on your long form 1040 from doing it. So maybe it doesn't count, you know? If it doesn't count for tax purposes, it doesn't count at all. But of course, some of the things that are easy to count don't really count for much. And some of the things that count most are impossible to count. So what uncountable thing could you do for others, for us? The answer? Believe in us before we believe in ourselves. One of the greatest gifts you could ever share with another human being. Wooden believed in his players, not just as individual stars, in fact, hardly at all as individual stars, but as crucial parts of a larger whole that was out there to express. This sounds pretty far out there to express excellence in the game of basketball by expressing excellence as human beings, leading human lives. That is perhaps the highest thing we can aspire to. But you see, if you aspire to that, you've taken sides. You've turned your back on the side that says this is about looking out for number one. This is the side about accumulating as much as you can and hoarding it to yourself. You've turned away from the side that says we make a living by what we get. No, you've oriented yourself in the opposite direction, away from we make a living by what we get toward we make a life by what we give, what we offer of ourselves. In a sense, it's uncountable, but it counts for more than anything else. I'm going to stop there. Do we have any time for questions or objections? I'm sure I got some things wrong. I just couldn't tell which ones they were. So maybe you can help set the record straight. Anybody have any comments or? It's a spirit-crushing blow to a speaker, you know, to have bared his heart and then meet with stony silence from from a large room full of people. So here's a call to the compassion, to the health professionals in the room, to come to the aid of a distressed speaker. There's one over here. Yes, sir.
I'm curious to know, how old were you when you learned more about John Wooden, and how did it change what you did?
I don't know exactly, but I'm going to say 45. Even though I was raised on the same Hoosier soil as John Wooden, I'd heard about him, I suppose, all my life, but never really gave it a second thought. And then I stumbled across something about Wooden that, for me, proved in some respects transformative. You can read different kind of books. You know, you can read history, romance, science fiction, detective novels, but you can also read biography. And I would suggest biography is one of the best genres for somebody who aspires to make a bigger contribution in life, because in the course of reading the biography of John Wooden, by the way, I don't like Seth Davis's biography of John Wooden, I'll just say that. In reading David Marinus's biography, When Pride Still Mattered, of Vince Lombardi, I could name a lot of other biographies. When you read those, you're not getting an instruction manual on what to do with your life. Somebody's holding up a mirror in which you can see your own life, right? In the course of reading this person's life story, I'm encouraged to reflect on my own. And as I see more clearly what my life is about, I'm better able to devote it to the purposes that really matter. So I was woefully ignorant of Wooden for a number of decades, but I'm glad I finally stumbled across him. And by the way, the Wooden story is just one of literally dozens. I mean, John Wooden was an extraordinarily successful coach. What if his teams had lost? What if he'd never won a national championship? We probably wouldn't be talking about him today. This is not the success story of John Wooden. This is not do this so you can be fabulously successful as well. This is a story of what somebody thought his life was about. The success is merely incidental. It's merely a byproduct of something bigger, more important that Wooden was working for, namely to contribute to the lives of other human beings. Yes, sir.
Thank you for a superb presentation. I would like you to comment. I realize because of time, you didn't have time to show the pyramid and actually mention what the individual morals and values. Could you comment on the pyramid, but specifically how each layer contributes to the final success of life?
Yeah, you may have heard of John Wooden's Pyramid of Success. You know, you could Google it right now, and I actually showed an image of it. I think in broad terms, Wooden thought the different parts of our lives need to be integrated, that it's bad to lead a life composed of silos where my personal and professional life never touch each other, where there's no cross-pollination between what we talk about at the dinner table. By the way, do you still have conversations at the dinner table? If not, that could be a problem. Anyway, the interaction between what we talk about at the dinner table and what we talk about at work. I think Wooden's pyramid embodies in part a realization that it's only when the parts of our lives cross-pollinate each other, when they're in contact and interact with each other, that the real benefits of cross-fertilization become possible. We can achieve a real synergy where those different, our life as a whole is more than the sum of its parts. And, that doesn't comment very specifically about any row of the pyramid, but I think it represents a really important overarching theme for Wooden. To lead a good human life, you've got to be the same person, no matter what room you're in, no matter who you're talking with, because every minute of every day is a chance to give life, and maybe even to testify, but certainly at least to give life to what you believe life is really all about. Our mission is to bring those ideas, those stories to life. What are your good stories? What's your best story, or one of your three or five best stories? When was the last time you shared that? John Wooden was constantly sharing stories because he thought that was the greatest gift he had to offer in terms of enriching the lives of others. I have such a story. April the 20th, some of you may recall, that was a Saturday. I'd been called in to the hospital for the second time that night for what we in radiology call an intussusception reduction. If the radiologist does her work right, this child won't have to go to surgery. Oddly, the second patient of the night, like the first patient, was a three-year-old boy. Strange coincidence. Two different patients, but both were three-year-old boys. You do this in the fluoroscopy suite. Procedure's underway. After a minute or two, this little boy starts to say to his father, who's kneeling at the head of the fluoroscopy table, "Daddy, it hurts." And there's good reason to think it does hurt when an intussusception is reduced. A little bit later, he says, "Doctor, don't." He wants me to stop. I'm not going to stop. Maybe I'm callous, maybe I'm heartless, maybe I'm uncaring, but I think I've got a mission here, and I think it's in the best interest of this child and his family that I persist. So another minute goes by, and I start to hear a sound that I can best characterize as whimpering. And a little bit later, that whimpering begins to verge into something I would describe as a quiet, still wailing. And then it hits me. Sometimes I hear that whimpering at the same time the little boy is saying, "Doctor, don't." And I realize that whimpering is coming not from the patient, but from the strapping young man, the child's father, kneeling at the head of the fluoroscopy table. His heart is going out to his son. He has entrusted in me responsibility for the care, maybe the life, of the most precious thing in the world to him. What did I ever do to deserve that trust? Surely not enough. But in that moment, any resentment I might have felt, you know, about coming into the hospital for the second time in the night, any frustration I was experiencing that this procedure wasn't going quite as well as I might have liked, that all melted away. And in that moment, I got reoriented. And I saw again why I was really there. In fact, why we're all really here. That may not sound like much, but that's a very recent story in my life that helped me figure out what we're really here to give. The extraordinary responsibility we bear and the incredible privilege it is to bear that responsibility. And I'm delighted to share that story with you, and I hope it's something you'll think about and that will help catalyze in you the recollection of a story in your professional life that can serve as a similar reorientation for you. It looks like we have 47 seconds left, probably not enough for a question, but I've really enjoyed this, and I hope this is, in a sense, not the end of a presentation, but the beginning of a conversation, and that we'll have occasion in the future to return to some of these matters and explore them anew. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gunderman. think Dr. Gunderman may have a little bit of time to stick around and do some book signing if you're interested. We have a break over the next 30 minutes until 2:30. I would once again encourage you to spend some time with our exhibitors and to participate in our conference app gamification. At 2:30, we're going to hear from Dr. Trevor Smith, who will be lecturing on the management of liver disease and complications of chronic kidney disease in ballrooms A and B. Michelle McComber and Dr. Courtney Latica will be lecturing on the state of medical marijuana in ballroom C. And at there will be three different skill labs that start at 2:30. Chest imaging for the non-radiologist will be in 321. Handheld ultrasound will be in room 305. And BLS will be offered in room 320. Thanks again.